I wanted to walk through some strategy tools. I'm basically arguing that people who do art, theater, music for social change actually need to not see themselves as the arts committee or auxiliary, but actually proactively think about how can we make our efforts most effective, what's the strategy, and
not leave that up to people who are good at databases, coordinating buses, or
running giant meetings. That actually people who make the images and tell the stories actually need to be dead serious about figuring out how do we make it make our efforts add up, and how do we successfully hopefully take down institutions and replace them with better ways of organizing. So are people up for, I'm a carpenter, so I like tools. Are people up for learning how to use a few new tools? Okay. So when people were doing sit-ins in the civil rights movement, they didn't just sort of one day pop into a lunch encounter, but they actually would plan campaigns. And the Fellowship of Reconciliation had a model that a lot of people used called actually Steps of a Direct Action Campaign. So the idea is that, and I would actually make this pitch to activists, that often we go from one event to another or one tactic to another without figuring out how do they all add up. And I think it's, for me, that's been often a recipe for burnout. And the stuff that's made me been most satisfying, and I felt like I've had the most impact, is when I work on campaigns where you actually figure out, okay, me and this group of people have a goal we're trying to achieve. Let's see if we can make all our efforts count in trying to reach that goal. So, you know, you get more skilled, stuff adds up. And that is, I think, so this is a model that they use in the civil rights movement. I'm gonna verbally walk through it, and then maybe we can actually break into groups and try it.
But the first part is being clear on your goals. And in the model there, they had,
what are your long-term goals?
And then the key one for me is the short-term goals. And I've added
systemic goals. So let's say you're an anti-war group trying to stop the war in Iraq.
Your long-term goal would be to
stop the war and occupation, right?
But you might actually say,
you know what, I know this isn't the first war in the U.S. as an empire.
So you might have a systemic goal of saying, we want to stop empire,
we want to stop war, something broader, which I encourage so that next generation of people don't have to start over again. And then the key thing, I think, is the short-term achievable goal. The idea that if you look at my experience with all the movements that I admire and that I see kicking butt, they win stuff along the way, and you can actually set yourself up to win or not to win. If you only have a long-term goal of stopping the war and occupation of Iraq, and you don't have something in between, it's going to be kind of depressing. That's a super long-term goal. It's tough. You're up against the biggest empire in the history of planet Earth. So if you don't set yourself up with, I think of it as crossing a river with little stepping stones that you can jump from one to the other and celebrate and feel like you're getting something and get experience of organizing with people and winning stuff, I think it's very tough. So I think we can set ourselves up for success by having short-term goals. And the three elements of a short-term goal is that it's measurable, so that you actually know when you've achieved it. It's achievable, it's not something that's beyond your reach, and that's actually useful. You're not doing it just to do something, but it actually helps you reach your goal. So if you're, you know, an anti-war group might say, maybe we're going to try and, we've done an analysis, we want to get kids to stop joining the military, so we're going to try and do 5 meetings in public schools in our town, you know, so that would be measurable. Achievable. I mean, my criteria is that you know when you've achieved it, and then you get to have a victory party because you said, "Hey, we did the 5 meetings. We reached out to hundreds of kids," and that is actually useful to your longer-term goal. So that's the goal piece. And I'll just say at this point, I'm walking through a bunch of tools and resources. I have an email I'm gonna send out to everyone that has all these tools and links to them, and also tools on a bunch of the different art stuff I talked about. So if you put your email on here and I can read it, I'll send everything I'm talking about to you. So, but the part I like is that they actually walk through a stage of, you know, obviously the real world is more complicated and you don't often start from scratch, but you start by investigating who has the power to make decisions. You know, before you even do public education or talk to power holders, you're like, you have them, and hopefully your research, find out how, who has the power to do what, how does it impact you, your communities, who are your possible allies. And then you educate your own group first, and then people in your community. Negotiate, that's often where you talk to those in power. It depends on what your campaign is, but, and it's often important to do it very publicly, make yourself look reasonable. Show the people in your community is like, look, we tried to talk to them, we were very reasonable. They either A, wouldn't talk to us, or B, they talked to us, but they wouldn't move on this important issue. Next, you would be, you've investigated, you tried to negotiate, you've educated the community, so it's time to hit the streets and demonstrate. And actually, and each one of these, you're trying to increase public support, increase pressure on your opponents, build your organization or movements. And you don't ever stop doing, you never stop researching, you never stop educating. You can continue negotiating or pushing them to negotiate, continue demonstrating. Now, to me, this is particularly important as someone who's comes out of direct action movements. My gut instinct is I like shutting things down. So I tend to want to go directly to here. But I think my experience is that if you haven't done these things first and laid a foundation and built community support, that doesn't have the same impact. If you do all this stuff, by the time you get here, hopefully you're creating a crisis in your opponent because you've already escalated pressure and built up support on your side. You know, and this is the part where I always think about how do you, you know, you escalate from demonstration to direct action. How do you both escalate to create more of a crisis, but also try and escalate in a way that you increase public support to some degree. So, you know, escalate, I call that horizontal escalation, where you can both be more militant, but also attract more support. And then the last part is you just keep doing it all until you win. And there's a handout that walks through it, and that actually has blanks where you figure out, okay, what is it we need to investigate? What are the things we're going to do to educate, negotiate, demonstrate, direct action, prolong the struggle? Let's see. Does that make sense to folks?
I'm thinking for time. I was going to do a have us do it, but maybe we'll do a walk through the other tools first. Is that okay? I think I want to do a power analysis tool called Pillars. Someone who I've learned a lot from, George Lakey, he wrote a book on direct action organizing in 1963, the year I was born, for the civil rights and other movements. But it's super common sense, but the idea is to analyze where the power is and things. So let's take an institution. Let's say we're all workers at Starbucks, right? And we're going to do a power analysis of Starbucks. So here's what happened at Starbucks is Raquel was doing a double soy latte espresso and burned herself badly because we haven't actually had any coffee breaks for the whole week because they've been short staff. So we're concerned that other workers might burn themselves. We want our goddamn coffee breaks, right? Are we going to put up with it?
No.
So it's a franchise owned by a local dude who's part of the franchise. So let's make this chair represent Starbucks. So we're going to analyze the pillars of Starbucks, and hold on to your Starbucks job. So a narrative of people who used pillar strategy is a student group in Serbia called Otpor was trying to get rid of Milosevic or protest him.
They did demonstration after demonstration. It's hard to build up because every time they protest, they get beaten up. So they took a step back. They heard about this pillars thing, did an analysis of like, okay, we keep getting beaten up. How do we do something different? And their analysis was that the pillar of Milosevic was the cops, and that if the cops didn't always repress people and beat people up, thank you, they'd be able to build more support and build more of a movement. So they stopped protesting Milosevic and did a campaign on the police and said, how can we weaken or remove the pillar of police that he depends on for his power? So they took pictures when they got beaten up at demonstrations. They blew them up. They went to the neighborhood of the cops. They went to the cops' kids' schools. And so the cops knew that if they're going to beat people up, and you know, people are sympathetic to these young students, right? So they created a political cost. They also, you know, they figured, they actually found out, you know, a bunch of people in the group knew somebody who knew somebody who knew a cop. So they actually fraternized and had meetings and tried to talk to the cops because they realized somehow they needed to break this as a solid pillar of support for Milosevic. You know, and so slowly that started to work to where the cops were aware there was going to be a political cost. They get embarrassed and humiliated at home. Some of the cops were like, people had meetings with them and said, hey, don't have to be on the wrong side of things. So flash forward to when there was a national mobilization, they took over the parliament. They actually had to bring in police from out of town because the cops had become unreliable to enforce it. And that was one of the things that led to, I mean, it's a very complicated scene, but they did manage to topple Milosevic over a short term period. And having the police not be as solid of a pillar of support was a key element. So to me, the takeaway is that had they kept protesting Milosevic and not done this other thing and taken a step back and figured out a strategy, he might never have been overthrown.
So that sounds like something you do kind of at the end when he's about to topple anyway, because otherwise the argument, if we go out and argue with the cops, we're not going to get the same result because we're nowhere near the stage of the struggle that they were at.
I mean, they did an analysis of young people in Serbia and said, that's the pillar we need to focus on. So we're Starbucks workers and we're going to do it now.
Those sound like they're based on Sharp's pictures.
Mm-hmm. Gene Sharp is an academic who did he looked at nonviolent action throughout history and did a sort of thorough academic exhaustive analysis of what are the dynamics, how does it work, and so he uses the pillars analysis a lot. So I'm going to jump back into Starbucks. Where does their power come from? What do they need to be able to continue?
Customers.
So they need money. Come on over here. So you're going to hold up one end of the chair, be money. What else do they need? Where does the money come from?
From the customer. Well,
we'll have you be the customers. What else do they need?
Shareholders.
Shareholders, although this is a local franchise, so you could go to the shareholders. Come up and be a shareholder. What else do they need?
Resources
like?
People.
Like, what kind of people?
Workers.
So workers. Somebody come up and be a worker. You guys want to lift that over your head? We've got customers, workers, and shareholders. Does that seem like maybe for this exercise, those are three. People say those. Is there any pillar that's more important than those three?
Well, what about coffee?
Do I have coffee? Supplier?
Cups.
Cups. Supplies. You can buy all those things, though. So let's just start with these three. So these are the pillars of our Starbucks branch. Are people serious about getting their coffee break?
Yeah.
Are you willing to struggle so that Raquel doesn't get burned again because she hasn't had a break in 3 days?
Yeah.
Okay. So let's say we don't want to have time for a long meeting. We want to come up with two or three things. What can we do to weaken the pillar? So they need customers, right? Otherwise, they don't do any business. They don't make any money. They can't buy anything, right? What do we do so we can win over the customers?
Tell the boss that you'll tell all the customers that he doesn't give us a break.
So
we threaten to like make the customers turn against the boss.
Should we threaten or should we actually start doing it? What do you think?
What if we tell the customers that we pee in the coffee?
So I mean, I'm going to jump in here and say, we want the customers to support it. And if you were a customer, would that make you want to support the workers? Or right here?
Maybe like have a little box on the counter that says like with these little slips that says like, sign this slip and show that you like support, you know, our coffee break. We just want a 5-minute coffee break.
Okay.
And then you can like dump them on the boss's desk.
And what if we maybe had someone who's not working at that time stand outside and with those slips in that box?
Yeah.
How's that sound?
Threaten the earnings.
And what?
Threaten the earnings.
Threaten their earnings.
One person puts themselves at risk.
Mm-hmm. So maybe we could have it be
a... So we have to find a way where we can all be together where the boss can't pick one person out.
Or we could ask allies in the community to do that for us.
The outside.
What? Let's come up with one other thing we can do. We're planning a campaign here. So we're going to leaflet the customers. What else can we do?
You could use a chalk drawing on the sidewalk to like tell the customers that way no one's actually standing there.
So the night before, there are a few people who'd be willing to go chalk the front of it saying, Starbucks workers don't get coffee breaks? Is that okay? So let...
10 days without a break.
Okay. Nice. So let's say we do those two things. You're no longer a worker. You're just a customer. You like your good coffee in the morning. Can you tell him what your leaflet says?
Hi. We like coffee and we like breaks just like you, but our boss hasn't been giving us that. And would you mind just like showing a little support with this? Because it's been like
And did you see what it says on the sidewalk there in chalk?
Mm-hmm.
You think you might not buy coffee today?
Yeah.
Oh, maybe. So,
I got it.
So let's remove that pillar. All right. And you're a worker, right? So what are we gonna do?
Strike. Sorry.
So let's come up with two things. Hold that thought. What are two things we want to do? Have we actually to get all the workers? What do we want to do with the workers? We want to maybe one, make sure they're all on board.
Yeah.
So maybe have
unionize,
or at least let's start by talking to each other. And then what can the worker? What's one other thing the workers can do to weaken that pillar or assert some
they
pressure?
Take the coffee break all together, and then when the boss comes in, just be like, too bad.
So it's like a 15-minute coffee break strike.
Yeah.
We got the strike in. Does that sound good? So we're going to get everyone on the same page. Maybe they'll know about it, and we're gonna basically put down the tools of our trade for 15 minutes and sip coffee. Would that weaken that pillar? Does it mean the line would back up out the door? You're out of there?
Okay.
So last one would be shareholders. Quick, just throw out two things we can do for shareholders.
Let them know that their business is being compromised by, their profits are at stake.
Right.
How do we let them know that?
How do we let them know that?
Social media campaign.
Shareholder meetings. We can send them some coffee cups with all of the information.
So send them coffee cups with messages from Starbucks workers. Does that sound good?
How do we know their address? How do we know their addresses?
Research.
Okay. Find out where the shareholder meetings are.
So, and then maybe somebody will CC the boss of our franchise, so he'll know that he's going to get heat.
Connect it to other similar struggles or situations elsewhere.
So if we notify the shareholders, copy the boss on it, you think that will make him nervous and we'll get our coffee break back? And can we take that pillar out?
Sure.
You can drop it.
Really?
I mean, don't break it, but. So that's the basic tool. So take the institution, I like having the physicality of it, and then analyze what are the pillars. You can actually draw them up, but it's fun to have people actually hold it up. And then I like it, I've actually used this to come up with campaigns look at the pillars, figure out which one's most important, which ones are we in the best position for. Maybe we actually, maybe, you know, your group is best situated towards the customers or the workers, you know, or if you're taking on climate change, or that one's big and daunting, but if you're taking on the war, you might think, you know, we actually did this, my anti-war group, we said, we think core pillars of the war are the soldiers, which includes future soldiers and recruits, the media, and corporations that profit off the war. So we looked at those, and then we said, okay, which one? So my group actually said, okay, there's nobody in the country right now doing support for soldiers who refuse to fight in the war. So we formed a group called Courage to Resist, and we sort of, we formed the group with a power analysis that if we support soldiers who refuse to fight in the war, similar to what happened in Vietnam, we think that might be a key pillar that we can weaken or remove the U.S. in Iraq. So does that tool make sense? I'll send people a link to it. All right. There's a group of folks people may have heard of called SmartMeme, which has changed their name to, I think, the Center for Story-Based Strategy. And they develop a tool based on the idea that the battle of the story is central. And so it's basically doing a sort of a narrative analysis of your opponents and the change agent. And so the first question, people have an example of a tangible struggle that that people are familiar with we could talk about? Some... The Rockaway pipeline? Can you give us 2-sentence description of the basic deal?
Yes, it was a pipeline that's been in the works for a couple of years without public input, and then they ended up writing a special rule for it to go through our national park right after Hurricane Sandy hit. So the public had no...
What do they pipe in that pipeline?
Pardon?
What's in the pipeline?
Or
what would be?
It's going to be natural gas.
Okay, I think you said that. And so that's great. How many people here are familiar with the Rockaway pipeline? All right, great. So
I'll just conceptually walk through it, and then maybe we'll break into groups. So the first part is the framing. What's the problem? Who's the conflict between? And this is where you get to frame it. So, you know, and the two pieces of this is, one is you're not going to do a caricature of this, you're going to actually honestly say, what's the opponent's story, and analyze it, and not just say, you know, this is equally important as figuring out what we're going to say, what they're going to say, and to actually understand it. And then who are their messengers? Who do they have communicate to the public or to the community? And then who do we have communicate to the public and the community? And often, the messengers are as important as the message, and we can often be flexible with, like, you know, do you speak publicly on the Rockaway issue?
Yeah.
And how do you identify yourself when you do as a...
As a citizen, I also work for an environmental organization.
Okay. So sometimes you can say, I'm a concerned citizen. Some people might add, I'm a student, I'm a parent, or some other things. So you can actually
disabled.
To say that.
Somebody that will be directly affected.
I live in a certain neighborhood, I live nearby. So those are all ways that you can, you know, proactively identify who you are, and you know, that way you might have more power. And then the next piece is, who are the messengers of the pipeline? Do they send people out to the community who are sympathetic?
They send people from Williams to buy little outfits and stuff like that for, like, so they come and they bribe community groups that don't have a lot of money. They tell people that they're providing jobs, that they're bringing people actually in from North Dakota. So they have this whole, like, public campaign that is completely false.
And then this is the key one for me, show, don't tell. Activists have a tendency to try and tell people what to think. And so, I mean, a super crass example would be, instead of saying George Bush is evil, you can tell a narrative is like, did you, the true fact, when he was a kid, he'd pull the legs off of lizards. And so that's a narrative, and you're not telling people what to think, but they'll draw their own conclusions. I read it somewhere. But, I mean, the idea is that you're appealing to people's values, you're not telling them your value judgment, you're just telling them, here's our story. Like the farm workers I work with, that I'll show pictures of later, they don't say, you know, the growers are bad. They say, here's what our working conditions are like, here's how we're treated, and then let people draw their own conclusions. And I think that's actually super important. Last two parts are foreshadow. How do we tell a story that sort of leads to the future that we want? So when the farm workers I work with, the Coalition of Mockley Workers, they often constantly talk about, you know, a future of justice for farm workers, and here's what it'll be like, and, you know, and the burden on the corporations of the unconscionable burden of supporting oppression will also be alleviated when we get our way. So telling the future, putting out your vision. What's the, do you do that around the Rockaways?
Yeah, there's a wind farm proposal for uh-huh. that can provide jobs and also like deaths on fossil fuels and also like setting up potential like test zones for wind energy mm-hmm. so close to the beach and things like that for like Broad Channel who has already a hard time getting gas, so they're not even going to benefit off of it. So, like, how about we set up, like, you know, test zones for renewables?
The last one is assumptions. What are the unstated assumptions? What do we have to believe to accept our opponent's stories or our story? So it might actually be worth thinking about. Will our story make sense? Do people have to believe certain things beforehand? What are those things? So just to unpack that. So, hey.
Assumptions like what? Like that wind can't work. So how do we change people's view that wind can work sort of thing? That natural gas isn't clean and it doesn't affect farms.
So it's like clarifying false assumptions.
Clarifying, is there anything in your message that you have to get people to wrap their head around before they'll believe your narrative?
Yeah, that well, showing that the workers that have been coming in to work on the pipeline mm-hmm. are no non-member from the local area, and they're not even staying in the local area. So that pissed people off already, mm-hmm. which was good because then they got engaged and started going to hearings and things like that. So I think they were fighting for jobs.
Well, maybe super quickly, if people can break into groups of about five and. Let's just do the first two of them. You're gonna, a reporter's gonna come over here and you're gonna have to pick somebody from the community who's gonna be your messenger. And just give a sentence or two about what's going on with the Rockaway Pipeline. What's the basic conflict to people who aren't familiar with it? And so you can lean on people who are more familiar if you want to. And you have like five minutes. Groups of five, just jump.
Hello, everybody. My name is David Solnit. I'm a reporter with CNN and New York Indie Media, depending on your orientation. And does your group have a spokesperson?
We have a mother.
Hi. We're here live, and we're talking to someone who's concerned about the pipeline in Rockaways. Can you tell us a little, what's the deal here for folks at home who may not know?
We weren't questioned about whether or not this pipeline could come through our community. And when it came through our community, we didn't have any electricity or any heat in our homes right after Hurricane Sandy. And we feel very out of the loop of the process, and this big international company is coming in and taking over our neighborhood.
And what's your name? I'm sorry.
My name is Jane Smith.
And are you a neighbor? What's your relationship to the pipeline?
I grew up in this neighborhood, and I'm raising my family here, and we feel very dedicated to living in this neighborhood, and we, you know, all of our friends and our family live around here too. Yeah.
hi, is there someone from this group I can talk to?
I don't think we came up with this spokesman.
Okay.
Sorry.
We'll be back later. Back here?
Yeah, sure. We'll try. We'll try. It's
hi, what's your name? Can you look into the camera?
Oh, George Smith.
George Smith.
Yeah.
What's the basic deal with this pipeline?
The basic deal with this pipeline is that it was pushed through after Sandy, and we didn't quite know that this was going to be happening, and now this project is 60%, 70% done, and we're finally able to educate our communities, and we've learned about this company that's putting this in, and we're really scared about the impact that this pipeline is going to have on our community.
Well, thank you. And who are you? What's your? Why are you concerned?
I live here. I've lived here my entire life.
Okay. Thank you. Good job. Someone over here? I see pointing fingers. Yeah? Hi, what's your name?
Hi, my name is Janet.
You're from the Smith family. I've talked to some of the other ones.
Yeah. Big family.
What's your concern with this pipeline?
Well, I'm an unemployed worker, and I've been unemployed for the last 5 years, mm-hmm. and they told us jobs were going to come, but from everything I hear, it seems that all the jobs, all the people for smoking from North Dakota are from North Dakota, and I'm from here, I'm still unemployed, and they're not fulfilling their promises to us. And besides that, we wouldn't want to be working there anyway because it sucks.
Thank you. Anyone over here? Hi, what's your name?
Hi, my name is Rosa.
Hey, Rosa. What's your involvement with this issue? Why are you concerned?
I am a mother, and I live in this area, and it was pushed through after Sandy, and we're already going through a very difficult time, and now suddenly we see that this is being built in the backyard, and we weren't even asked about it. Mm-hmm.
But won't it bring jobs, and don't you use energy in your household for your kids?
Yeah, but I'm concerned about what's going to happen later, and all the contamination that's going to happen, and the displacement.
Thank you. Yay. That was amazing. That was, just so you know, you can have a 5-minute media preparation meeting. But people framed the conflict very positively, and also a lot of people identified as sympathetic characters from the neighborhood, a mom. Any other observations on that one? Come on in.
We have to move a carload of stuff.
Oh, that's your destiny. You're going to have a carload of stuff to move until you...
All
right.
I think you actually framed half of the problem by being a good reporter, actually being as an activist reporter and framing the question properly rather than working for the industry and making mm-hmm. a fool out of them.
Although I gave her a hard time and she responded pretty elegantly. But, I mean, I was, in a longer thing, you could have a more hostile reporter, but that's, and it's, I actually like the tool of, you know, if you're actually going to be out in public when we, used to do direct action trainings, we'd actually like put a microphone in everyone and say, why are you flooding Wall Street or whatever? And it's not just, even if you hate corporate media, you still have to be able to articulate it for the person on the street, your mom, your housemate, whoever. Yeah. So it's good practice to be able to articulate that. But and how do you frame things in a way? I mean, that's super core. So I find this super useful, and in case you haven't noticed, I like strategy tools. Like, experienced activists have this stuff intuitive in their head from lots of experience, but if you can actually put it on a piece of paper, you can sort of democratize strategy, sit around with a group and walk people through it, and then everybody understands the strategy or the story you're telling, the opponent's story, and I think it's key to, I mean, we need strategic movements and we need everybody, not just a few people who are seasoned or you know, have jobs doing it, but everybody has to understand the strategy and try and think about what can we do differently or better.
I wanted to ask you about, I guess, the democratic process of deciding on a direct action. Are you using the pillar activity to determine that, like that would have been an effective bridge to that, but I'm wondering what your tools are in determining what a direct action is going to be, or what an action is going to be, so that it's not coming from one person. Because I feel like that happens a lot, where you don't really know where this action is coming from, or who's deciding if that's going to be the most effective tool.
This would be a good place to do it. And I think what you said is these are also super democratizing in that, especially as you get more experience, you kind of internalize and figure this out. But if you can actually make it transparent and clear, you can bring the whole group through the process. So it's like, you know, you can ask your group, you know, if we're going to flood Wall Street, what are our systemic and long-term goals? What's the short-term goal? You could set those. And then you can say, well, you know, maybe running naked through the streets won't achieve our long-term goal of building broad public support, whereas dressing in blue will, or whatever. I mean, and then this is, I mean, I think any kind of a participatory, transparent strategy tool is good to democratize, you know. And the more people who have their head wrapped around both how strategy works, but also have worked through the group's strategy. I mean, I've actually used some of these tools like the pillars. I was in a grassroots group in Las Vegas fighting against nuclear testing, and we all walked through the process, and so we all got it. And so it wasn't just the seasoned organizers, it was everybody who was sort of bought into our little strategy. One last tool, and then I'll show some pictures. And this actually is a little bit more of a framework than a simple tool, but this is actually a tool that George Lakey used. He studied social movements around and sort of said, I think they go through these stages. So one way of saying it is, see if I can actually pull out that. The basic idea is that social movements go through a series of stages as they build up, and this is, and often different sectors of them go through these stages at different time. So if you actually understand, I think for those who were around for Occupy, it was super true that, you know, people in Occupy were ready to overthrow the system, but they were actually kind of somewhere up here in these stages. And so the idea of cultural preparation is that's as a society where you do your basic consciousness raising. It's like, what's the problem? How does it affect us? Are you ready to take action? When I work with the farm workers, they have public meetings in the town, and they talk to people about what are the economic conditions, why are people ready to do something about it. So that's sort of the consciousness raising. So as a society, you know, go ahead.
Wasn't maybe cultural preparation Occupy Wall Street for this now?
Some ways, yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. I mean, it was.
3 years?
I mean, I think Occupy Wall Street around the country got people to wrap their head around, oh wow, income equality, it's fucked. People kind of knew it, but it gave language and articulation and prepared people for taking more action. You know, and then organization building is starting to build networks, organizations, ways of working together. And then confrontation is the smaller actions. And by smaller, I mean actually like Flood Wall Street was a smaller action in contrast to the scale of mass non-cooperation or resistance. So it's, you know, those are where you want to have your catalytic direct actions that get people energized, frame the story. And then the idea is that in each one of these, in both cultural preparation and organization building, you're basically sort of tooling yourself up to get to this point where you're actually, so you're creating alternative institutions. Like when we do our demonstrations, we often have like medics and people who do food and different stuff. So in some ways those can be seen as little seeds of like, okay, we're kind of gearing up a little bit to reorganize society. We're not quite ready to take over alternative food systems for all of New York City, but you know, we're starting small. And then the idea is that these will be catalytic to lead to mass political and economic non-cooperation, you know, the scale where you can actually, what's examples of, I mean, a classic example was the Philippines where the people power forced Marcos out, and that was massive political and economic non-cooperation by both the citizens who went part of the military rebelled against him, tens of thousands of people surrounded them and protected them from other parts of the military, and then other parts of the military began to rebel. So he had both, he had widespread non-cooperation until he actually fled. So, I mean, picturing it in the United States. And then parallel institutions is the idea that as you're doing the confrontational, oppositional stuff, from here on you're starting to think about how are we going to reorganize society. Like, that's the sort of like, I like Mona's artwork for that, and that you have the two things here, which is so resistance, which is the confrontation and the non-cooperation, and then disseminate alternatives. That's the, you know, in our movements, we often have people who are drawn towards, you know, I want to do the constructive thing, I want to build gardens and networks and alternative neighborhood structures and that. And then you have people more like me who are like, you know, we want to fuck shit up and shut things down. And you need both of them in a movement. Sometimes it's the same people, but sometimes not. You know, and then the people who are good at, you know, organization building and setting up the meetings and maintaining the listservs and creating networks and going to the conference in the next state over and all that stuff. So the idea is that these are both different stages you go through and also somewhat different roles that different people take on. I'm just sort of showing that for me it's the best model I've seen in terms of thinking about a revolutionary movement, meaning that this is my belief that we need to replace the economic and political institutions with directly democratic and ecological ones that won't create climate change and will give our communities power.
So as an art making strategist for movement, I often find like I feel compelled to be at various places in this chart, and like how do you navigate wanting to be in more than one place, or like as an art making ally, like to all of those things, like how do you mediate not overextending yourself or like get like being the most effective for what you do, and like not trying to be the organization building confrontation plus parallel institution, whatever, like, and being an effective like visual narrative strategist, like. At the same time, because I feel
you
like...
You have to figure out where you are most drawn. I mean,
with the Immokalee workers, they did a cantastoria. I mean, I brought the paint and the fabric and showed them an example, and they painted it, and they used that for their cultural preparation. They actually used their own, use it for their consciousness raising. You know, confrontation, that's what we did last week. We all made a lot of art for that, for parallel institutions. You know, there's... Who here has done art for some community institution that's a seed or an alternative? Anyone? What was the institution?
Well, I made art for the Icarus Project, which kind of counts.
Mm-hmm.
It's like radical mental support.
Yeah. Or Anna and Remy and I did a banner for the Mayday out there, which. We're hopefully going to get Crystal to bust something out on at her leisure. So, but I'll send this out. I think I find it helpful for me personally to actually see things like what we did this weekend placed in a bigger context. And that, I mean, I think this last weekend was pretty amazing. I mean, I organized as hard as I could in the lead up to Copenhagen in 2009, and the peak of our organizing, I think we had on October 24th about 25 actions around the country. The largest one was 1,000 people. So, you know, that's what, 5 years forward, and the scale is pretty phenomenal. So I'm super excited, and you know, and I feel like Flood Wall Street was a badass group of local people who took on a lot in a short time, you know, and I think showed that there's actually broad public support for mass direct action. You know, so imagine what we could do if we had 6 months to do that, or next time. I'll send that out to people. Can I show some images?
Yes.
So this was a logo. Where's a good place for me? This was a logo from Art and Revolution Collective that
Seattle.
Formed in the 90s and was sort of a concept and also a network of street theater collectives around the country. And we did mass trainings and trained artists and performers how to blockade and run meetings and do lockdowns and do media and train performers and artists. We trained performers, artists how to do that, trained activists how to make art and theater and music, and with the idea of integrating them and trying to infuse art and culture into movements. And so, and sort of Seattle was in one culmination of that. Shall I push forward?
Yeah. 1 second.
Yeah. So Seattle WTO was, as I said, it was actually in the direct action part of it was initiated by street theater collectives, which I love. And this is delegates trying to get through our blockade lines. And that's what the streets looked like. Should I say click or?
Yeah, click. Wait, no, say forward. Wait, no.
And that's us getting tear gassed. Keep going. And so, in some ways, as artists, I mean, frankly, the most powerful image is, or you know, our demonstrations are a performance. Like, I don't actually see a difference between a street theater performance, a protest, and a ritual. So, you know, there's no art we could make that's more powerful than that dude blocking that delegate. So I also think, as artists, how do we shape direct actions so they're super clear and powerful? And they're also rituals, how do we make them so there's space for not just one narrow feeling, like we're angry and pissed, but a range of feelings. Go. And our opponents also have their street theater. Go. Nasher. Go. Giant puppet. So that's this one. If we had taken the time and sculpted it out of cardboard, and then they're actually paper macheing it. Go. And we did a series of processions through the neighborhoods around Seattle in the lead up. And so we sort of consciously made them very positive and festive, and we called the whole thing a festival of resistance. So, you know, this is what our neighborhood procession looked like. So I think it had something to do with drawing people out, the fact that we were so positive, and you saw what the cops looked like. Go.
I like that.
Go. 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 That was that's our little strategy map. We kept arguing about where we thought the police lines were be, and we couldn't figure it out, so we just divided the city into pie slices and got clusters of affinity groups to take on each slice, so that no matter where the cops were, your job, if that was your slice, was to stop any vehicular traffic or pedestrian traffic from getting to the convention center, which is the triangular thing in the middle.
What was the duration of time for the organizing process? The actual boots on the grounds?
I mean, we floated the idea 6 months out and really did 3 months of organizing. And a few of us moved up there, and a lot of people lived there. You know, and there was a magic thing that happens sometimes in actions when you go through all those steps and do your community education, where we had maybe 2,000 people organized into affinity groups who were there at 7 a.m. ready to lock down and blockade stuff. But at a certain moment, it became that everybody in the streets, a lot of whom had never had any contact with our organization, been to any training or anything, were ready to blockade, because we were literally surrounding the convention center, linking arms and physically holding out delegates. Uh-huh. And so we had tactical people on bullhorns saying, help, this one needs more help. And ordinary people who knew it was a protest, because it was all over the news, just showed up and joined in. So I think when we do our work well, we transition from being an organized resistance to being a public uprising, where it makes sense to people in your community and they just join in, and also coming up with tactics that all you had to do is go like this with the person, and that's it. So it was very easy to plug in. That was amazing. I'm jumping into other campaigns. We were doing a protest in support of Nigerians who were in court against an oil company. We wanted to have images of Nigerians, so we had someone send a photo of their folks, blew them up at FedEx on big paper, wheat pasted them on cardboard, and just colorized them a little bit and put the demands the Nigerians had asked us to promote. And that was actually a Chronicle, our local newspaper, footage. So it was super simple. And go. I'm jumping around the world. This is with Mona, and I got invited to Cochabamba, Bolivia for the 10-year of the water war in 2000 when a popular uprising kicked Bechtel out from privatizing their water and was a major pushback against or the neoliberal elites that opened up huge political space. So they, for the water war, we brainstormed what would be a good iconic image to lead the march, and we said, let's make a giant drop of water with a face. So keep going, go. So the way I learned to make really fancy masks is you sculpt clay and then paper mache, cover it with plastic and paper mache over it. But clay is hard to sculpt for ordinary people and it's expensive. So you can either use, if you use mud, but my friend had a big sandbox at their kid, they had too much sand for the kid's sandbox, so they had all these sacks. So we just used wet sand, covered it with a light plastic, and then can you go back one? And then we paper mache'd it, and this is, I think, about 12 feet tall. And the paper mache, if you soak cardboard boxes in water overnight, it separates, and you get rid of the wiggly part, but the front and back, it's like, counts like six or seven times newspaper, or two or three times brown paper bag, so we're able to build up a super strong shell of cardboard wheat paste. Can you go forward, too? Reinforced the back after it dried and we pulled it off. And go. And then
beautiful.
Painted it with a lovely Mona.
Oh my God.
And forward. And then that was so that got to lead the march. Go ahead. And we brainstormed what should the signs be about, and it was all about water, so that was our standard picket sign. And we had to put a little bit of wire in the top faucet so it wouldn't flop. Go. This is the folks at Uprose who painted all the art standing in front of the parachute they just finished painting. Go. I'm sorry, I'm bouncing. I'm back in Bolivia. This is we did a one-day art party and the kids made a giant puppet for the commemoration. Go.
Whoa.
We did puppet workshops with all the water committees, and I think they said it helped with the mobilization because a lot of families came out and made the art, and then they wanted to march with it.
Sure.
Go. Go. So that was fun. Actually, we just took soil and got it wet and made mud and then covered it with trash bags, sculpted it. It was super fun. It was a group of kids, so they got to, like, as part of their sort of homeschooling, they got to like play with mud and then make art.
In Bolivia,
yeah.
And there we sculpted it with the plastic.
We sculpted the mud and then laid the plastic. The best plastic is like dry cleaner, really light plastic, so you don't get the wrinkles. But yeah, but it was a good art project, that sculpting the sand. Go.
Oh, yeah.
Is there some puppet heads people made in Bolivia? Go. Getting ready for the march. Go. Is that they had a water fair where everybody sort of showed off. Each in the poor section of Cochabamba, every neighborhood has to self-organize their own water system. So the core form of organization in those neighborhoods is the water committee. Mm-hmm. And they actually dig trenches and put pipes in and have a lot of amazing backyard technicians, like people who hook up V8 engines to the water pipes to push it up the hill and stuff like that. Amazing stuff. Go. That was the march. Go. And this is actually part of the ancestry of sunflowers. We went to the U.S. Social Forum, I think, in 2010 and brainstormed with the community groups in Detroit who are fighting the incinerator you see behind them, which is a toxic trash incinerator, which both creates a lot of carbon for the climate and is in a residential neighborhood and pollutes the neighbors. So they sort of, we collectively came up with the idea of sunflowers. So it transformed the whole march into sunflowers. Go. That was the app, sort of a conference call sketches of what we were gonna do. Go. So we made a mock incinerator that the bricks, they, all the stuff that it represents, and so and it got down. Pushed on me. Say again?
It came down and...
We didn't pull it down. We had scary people with masks pushing it along, but it was just sort of a prop to represent the incinerator. Go. That's here. Go. 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 That's two people that Amy works closely with in the Bay Area, Penny and Allison, who came and painted the indigenous banner on the rooftop. Go. So just a note on painting parachutes. In the past, I've always thinned the water, thinned the paint half water, but somehow with these ones, I actually went, I thinned it just a tiny bit, but I went almost full strength, and it still needs some more experimentation. Some of the orange, on some of the parachutes, the paint started to flake a little bit. But this one's, I think, went to North Dakota and is now headed to the Bay Area.
Where did you take this photo?
This is climbing on the roof. Yeah. There's actually a ventilation system, which you can kind of scramble up to the top of. You're probably not supposed to. But we got Mona up there. Drone. Yeah.
You were experiencing it flaking with house paint, acrylic paint?
On some of them. So if I were to do it again, I would paint it, let it dry, and then move it a bunch and see how it did. Mm-hmm. Go.
We stacked them the other day. I think it's an issue too.
Go.
I think the ones that we did on the roof where they dried better were better. Okay.
That was Mona's design for the Flood Wall Street parachute. Go. 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 What I loved about Seth's design is you could almost take out all the words and it has a whole analysis of capitalism and climate. So it's sort of, that's like show, don't tell. Yeah. Anyway. Go. Go. This is the kids in Detroit who made a bunch of the sunflowers. And then we did this fun project where that's this stretch muslin on a light wood frame. And then we stuck a sunflower. The idea is it was supposed to be a giant planter box that they would paint a mural of. So, you know, so we went to a bunch of different communities and said, what would you like to see instead of an incinerator in your community? So they have one side's a dirty asthma lung and the other's a clean air lung.
Oh my God.
Go. Go. This is a community in Detroit that doesn't have a name. It's just called 48217.
Has there been an action of actually planting sunflowers?
We've also used that image in Richmond, California. And so we actually planted actual sunflowers and gave people packets of sunflower seeds to plant along the refinery. And yeah. We did a lot. You did a lot. And then part of the idea in Richmond was from community gardeners who said, when you plant sunflowers, it actually helps take out some of the toxins and metals from the soil. So it's sort of both symbolic but also practical, as well as kind of being a symbol of community gardening. Go. So, go. This is Fort Benning, Georgia, where every year there's a big, it's where School of Americas is located that trains paramilitaries and militaries throughout the Americas. Can you go? And so we've done puppet making. We did puppet making there for many years, but what I wanted to show here is that we make all the images and then create a very simple storyline and perform a pageant. And usually 20 or 30 of us will make all the art, come up with the storyline, and then we'll get volunteers an hour before. It's a little bit similar to how Bread and Puppet organizes their pageants. and then give people very simple props and a few different simple movements, nothing complicated. And so a pageant is somewhere between a parade and a street theater. We'll often have someone narrating with music or some simple language. Go. And so a lot of color coordination of different groups of images representing different stuff that will move through the crowd.
Where was that?
This was, again, School of the Americas. So at the height, we'd do a pageant with 300 performers that we'd train like 250 of them an hour before and performing for a crowd of 10 to 20,000 who come out there every year. Mm-hmm. And a lot of these puppet heads are people's first attempts. Go. Go. This was a, at the end of it, we raised a 20, it's like a 22-foot puppet head. Yeah. Go. Go. He said, a better world is under construction. Go.
So why the corn?
That group was campesinos, so it was sort of a symbol. So they've got corn and machetes and puppets.
For the farm worker.
Mm-hmm. I think in this each, the years I was involved, we would tell a different story each year. So I think this year we were telling the story of the Coalition of Immokalee Workers, other years. And it's always very handy because the workers were there themselves. So they got up on stage and told their story and we acted it out. Another year we did the Argentine Uprising, I think in 2002. And another year, one of the guys who's active around it is Carlos Mauricio from San Francisco. And he was a professor in El Salvador and was kidnapped and tortured during the dirty wars there. And so he then, through the Alien Claims Tort Act, sued his torturers, the head of the police and military who had immigrated to Miami and won in court. So we actually created a giant pageant and told his story and then we projected into the future. He had always wanted the place where he was tortured, the police headquarters, to be transformed as the one in Chile was, into a museum for human rights. So at the end of the pageant, we had built a giant police headquarters. We flipped it around and it became a museum of human rights. And he narrated it himself, which was super powerful. Go. Go. That's it. Yeah, let's end with, I didn't do the Immokalee farm workers, let's end with that. I have two-minute videos. You can pull that up. Scroll down. The CIW March on Publix. So these were farm workers and the Immokalee workers brainstormed theater and imagery, and Mona and I and others worked with them to create it all. This is at the end of a long march in Central Florida.
So how did you get down there? I mean, like, did they ask you to come, or how did that happen?
Actually, after Seattle WTO, they met me at a student sweatshop conference and invited me to come make art with them. So I got to collaborate with them on art for the first cross-country caravan. And they, you know, they were organized by Haitian peasant organizers and Central American organizers, so they automatically had art and culture at the heart of their organizing. So in summary, huge encouragement to being hardcore cultural arts organizers and overthrowing capitalism in the United States government. And I mean, I'm partly, is how I've been active since I was 18. I'm 50 now. So the last 15 years, organizing art and the people who are drawn towards that has helped sustain me. So much encouragement and super thanks to the folks who created the space to do that here. Speaking of which, I wanted to and I think Rachel and Raquel, you want to tell us about what's next for the space?
Sure.
You want to tell us something?
We're in a super exciting moment here in New York to
make a lot more awesome stuff like we learned about tonight happen after People's Climate March. There's so much excitement and energy and a room like this of people, many of whom I myself have either met in the last month or so or haven't met before. For those of you who don't know, Rachel, this is Raquel, and we were on the People's Climate March art organizing team. There's going to be some meetings coming up in the next month or so to help us figure out how we can all keep working together and keep the momentum and excitement of arts-based resistance to climate chaos and capitalism alive and growing in New York City.
Two last things. One is, do you have time if anyone list the resources of everything I talked about tonight, come up here and sign it. And the second is a request. Can everybody stand up? And I was going to say we could close with a power clap like the farm workers do in California. And at the end of the power clap, we're going to clap slow and get faster and faster and end with a si se puede. I'm going to ask everyone to find somebody they don't know and just introduce yourself and say one thought you had about this evening. So power clap.